When polyester was invented, the goal was to create a durable and resistant fabric that could retain its color and shape without wrinkles. Nearly 85 years later, polyester is everywhere. Today, most clothes contain synthetic material, and much of that material is derived from plastic. What made this fabric magic at one point is now the reason for its disrepute. And with less than 1% of textile waste recycled into new garments, the vast majority of the clothes we wear end up in landfill.
Between 22 and 23, manufacturing of textile fibers in the world grew from 116 to 124 million tons. All of that growth was from polyester. Now, the problem with polyester, it's not going to disappear.
But what if there was a way to break down these fibers and recycle polyester into new clothing infinitely? It's a question that prompted French engineering group Technip Energies to collaborate with American business tech leader IBM.
Reju is aiming at building a complete ecosystem to tackle the challenge of textile-to-textile recycling.
We have been concerned about circularity in the carbon economy for a long time. And that led over a couple of years of conversations with Arnaud to saying, let's see if we can progress this to whether it's real, not just a science lab experiment.
What's unique about Reju is our ability to take the polyester out and then depolymerize the polyester. We could potentially not need to take any new raw materials out of the ground to make polyester.
The whole story started at Technip Energies in one of our labs, and the team telling us, listen, we do have something around textile-to-textile recycling. In order to achieve the complete flow sheet, we need a few partners. We found the IP that is missing at IBM.
One of our researchers had come up with a way to find a much, much more cost-effective way, in principle, of recycling a particular kind of polyester called PET. And then we said, all right, but we are not going to be in this business, so how do we find a partner who might be interested?
I was CEO at Under Armour at the time, and we were looking for a new technology to enable us to really get access to polyester at scale from textile source in the future. IBM had a technology called Volcat at the time that they announced in 2019. Technip had the engineering capability.
While you can already buy clothes made from recycled polyester, most of it comes from plastic bottles, not recycled clothing. A textile-to-textile solution that cuts recycled bottles from the process altogether could prove to be a more sustainable solution.
You take polyester. Polyester is a polymer. You break it down into bits and parts to go back to the monomer. You regenerate the monomer, so the basic molecule, and you recreate the long chain again. It's named chemical recycling, so there's no burning, there's no heat. It's all a chemical process. And in the process, we are purifying the product. We're separating polyester from cotton, from dye, and you rebuild a longer chain of the polymer itself. What made us want to lead there? First, the technology we had, it's too good not to be deployed. Two, that we can scale this up probably better than no one else. And then it's, you know, as a citizen of the world, you think about the hundreds of millions of tons of textile being dumped into deserts every year, and that is a concern to me.
Technip Energies is best known for energy engineering, such as LNG, hydrogen, and carbon capture. But the company has also been involved in the chemical market. In 2014, the firm, under a previous entity, acquired Zimmer Polymer in Frankfurt, one of the originators of polyester science and manufacturing.
The core knowledge is around the molecule. So we can go from whatever feedstock, oil, gas, and transform that into whatever end product.
What's missing today is really the entire slice, if you like, in the circularity model of textile to textile regeneration or recycling. That begins from waste aggregation all the way to reintroduction into the textile value chain. We realized that if we were going to be able to be successful, it was not just about the technology.
We own a certain amount of the intellectual property. We have given it to Reju as part of our equity share in the entity.
Total investment so far, including, I would say, the regeneration hub zero that we have built and erected in Frankfurt, is something around 100 million euro to date.
Today, we're very, very lucky and very fortunate. You know, we have one of the largest engineering companies in the world behind us, and currently being, you know, 100% also funded by Technip Energies.
Reju started about 4 or 5 years ago. So there's more to come. In 2025, for example, we said that this could represent up to another 50 million. We were likely going to open the capital of Reju to other parties interested into the scale-up.
As a talk to Arno and some of his people, it became clear in my head, what we tend to do is very, very high-end science, and I'm okay to put very expensive people and equipment against it. But when you really need to make it scale, it's kind of got to work, as I put it. You're building this plant. The plant may cost a couple of $100 million. You got these steel pipes and processes and distillation things. It's got to work and all that.
We have actually designed most of the technology you see in this place inside of our company, which is, of course, a competitive advantage, but also something that's very challenging because you do not know to begin with whether everything is going to work, you know, seamlessly. So that's one of the reasons why you build one of these demo plants.
Each plant will generate or recycle 50,000 tons per annum. So if you do 10 plants, you're in 500,000 ton. So it's already half of what is being recycled today. And our ambition is certainly not to stop at 2 plants or 10 plants, but to go 20, 40.
Our team who was working on it really came at it from a science perspective. They weren't necessarily the best at thinking about if it gets up to 100,000 metric tons a year, what will that scale look like?
IBM, much larger company than Technip Energies. So to be able to align, I would say, the pace of an IBM or a Technip Energies to IBM, we go probably a lot faster than they go. But the beauty is that with Arvind, IBM CEO, basically he aligned his organization and he gave them the space to breathe and to move at our pace. And then the big challenge that we were facing and we are still facing is, why do you think that Reju is going to succeed where everyone else has failed?
The textile-to-textile market, while nascent, has been growing through different parts of the supply chain. German company Soex focuses on sorting clothing by material and color, using AI in the recognition process. American business Circ is the developer of a technology that separates polyester from cotton without damaging the fibers. And firm Avenue recycles cotton fibers by shredding and liquefying them into pulp, allowing them to extrude new fibers for clothing.
If you would have asked me 5 years ago or 10 years ago, Patrick, you're going to be the CEO of a chemical engineering company, I would have probably thought that you were a little bit crazy. I've learned a ton.
We've learned from IBM how digital can actually accelerate innovation. From Patrick, we've learned about branding and the power of marketing.
I learned a lot about how lean can one be when one is taking something from the lab into real life. I definitely learned that from Arno as he was trying to think through, how do I go small? How do I go fast?
Patrick, for example, joining Reju and being the CEO of Reju, he knew about his value chain from a sporting, from a brand perspective. What to buy, where from, with what quality.
And by the way, on a side note, Arno and I share a love for fast cars. So that actually also became a lot of fun to talk about all along the way.
So in spite of the distance, in spite of the fact that we were meeting through Teams, we found a really very quickly a common ground, a common interest, and a common ambition. It was about doing good, but it was about doing good through a business. So the returns are not financial today, because we went from lab to demo plant, and next is to go full scale. So the returns will start kicking in 2027, 2028, and beyond.
Regeneration Hub Zero opened in Frankfurt, Germany in October 2024. The demo plant has the capacity to produce 1,000 metric tons per year of the brand's proprietary product, Reju Polyester.
So what we have here is pure polyester, which is something that we need when we begin to calibrate all of the equipment inside of Regeneration Hub Zero. And this is what it looks like coming in. And also, after we're done here at Regeneration Hub Zero, what we polymerize back into. So this is actually what's needed to make fibers and yarns again in the circular loop. Inside of here you have over 500 valves, 42 kilometers of electrical wiring, 4 kilometers of pipe, and also over 200 different process instruments.
Reju's technology is based off the Volcat, or volatile catalyst, developed by IBM. The process involves rejuvenating PET found in some packaging and polyester.
It came out of the team that works on semiconductor materials. It was like an aha. It's almost like, you know, the people who invent sticky tape or 3M. I'm working on something else, but oh, look what I discovered. plastics are incredibly hard to break down. If you want to recycle it, you gotta worry a lot about, do I need very high temperatures? Do I need very high pressures? Do I need all kinds of exotic catalysts? Those exist, but then it becomes very expensive because high temperature means a lot of energy and heat. Expensive reagents means lots of money being spent on chemicals. So could you, using much, much more common reagents, think maybe things like baking soda, I'm being a little facetious, but you know, in that range, and think of temperatures that are high but not that high, so we can bring the cost down to maybe a tenth of where it was before.
It's going to be made by 10, for 10. It is designed in a way that is absolutely scalable. If the concept works, we can also actually license the solutions to others in the world.
I'm 100% sure can be scaled up, but let's get the 50,000 ton plant up and going. If that becomes successful, should we build multiple of them, or should we think about converting it into one bigger plant? I think those are wonderful options. In our business, I would turn around and say that's a great problem to have.
We were very clear about our near-term ambition to become a 2 billion euro company in 2034. To be able to get there, you would have to build much larger regeneration hubs than the one we're in right now. So our aim is to actually build the first two regeneration hubs ready by 2028. And we will have one in Europe and we'll have one in the US.
We are producing more than 20 times more polyester fiber per year than we were 50 years ago, growth that has carried a heavy eco-footprint. Fast fashion helped to exacerbate the problem, with the typical European consumer generating about 16 kilograms of textile waste in a year.
Having worked in this industry for so long, having seen so many different brands, basically across all the different sectors of apparel, footwear, and accessories, it was never clear to me that the impact it would have over time as we grew the business would be so dramatic.
100 million tons per annum of polyester being dumped. We only recycle about 1% of that as a world, okay? It's 1 million tons per annum. It's nothing.
People talk a lot about mitigation and reduction. I think that's important. But to me, that's only one third of the problem on the whole hydrocarbon cycle. So we can't be obsessed with just one third. The second third, by the way, I think is efficiency. Can we reduce the amount we need because we can use it better? And the third, I think, is circularity.
The mandates and the regulation is starting now to align in Europe, US, etc., around forcing brands to use recycled polyethylene and polyester, etc. So we can see that the planets are starting to align. It's taking too much time, if you ask me.
Sponsored by